Thank you, Ken, and good evening all. We have two portions of the concert. By far the longest one is Carmina Burana, which will be after intermission without any interruption. But we're going to start with two works by Giuseppe Verdi, both from the same opera, Nabucco. His third opera, by the way, 32 operas, Giuseppe Verdi, shows the story of the historical Nebuchadnezzar, which in Italian is Nabucco, well, it's a shortened version actually, who conquered and enslaved the Jews around 490 BC. The libretto derived from the biblical books of Daniel and Jeremiah. Being an Italian opera, there's of course a love story included in the plot. It's also considerable deviation from historical fact, but we're not concerned about that. The opera dates from 1841. Nabucco established Verdi as the most important composer of Italy in the 19th century, and some would say the most important Italian composer maybe ever. Verdi said, this is an opera, quote, this is the opera that signaled the real beginning of my artistic career. He'd written a couple of operas before. One was unsuccessful, the other was moderately successful, but this one really established him for reasons beyond the music. Beginning this evening, we'll offer the overture, which contains many of the motifs found in the opera itself, the melodies, famous Verdi choruses, Val Pensiero will follow. In the 1840s, 50s, and 60s, there was a turbulent time in Italy. I suppose there were turbulent times throughout Europe, but in that particular peninsula especially. Under the thumb of foreign powers, the Italians were not free to choose their own government, their own leaders, and what have you. Hundreds of years, 300 years or more, the Italians had been constricted by either the Spanish, French, or the Austrians in various different parts of the country. The Italians refer to this period as the Risorgimento, or the resurgence, the desire to have self-determination and have Italians running the government. And that, of course, took place around 1870. This rebellion resulted in conflict and defiance. Nabucco was seen as a gesture of support for the politicians and military stance of the people. In the eyes of the people, there was no hiding the fact that the Babylonians were a metaphor for the French, or the Austrians, or the Spanish. Different parts of the country and different times of that period. And the Italian people were the Jews who were put upon, were enslaved, more so I think than the Italian people, but nonetheless the metaphor is still there. Val Pensiero, to be led by Pasquale Pasquaretti, the director of the Metropolitan Detroit Chorale, is thought of as a kind of unofficial anthem in Italy. The text speaks of yearning for freedom, and the remembrance of the days of home in Jerusalem. The fly thoughts on golden wings is the beginning of the translation of the text, a worthwhile translation at that time of the text. This was chosen for something that was so spontaneous that at Verdi's funeral in 1901, the crowd broke into song in the street in that particular chorus. So, first the overture, then Val Pensiero.
Thank you.
And now for Carmina Burana. For starters, the title refers to two things. Songs, which in Latin is Carmina, and Burana is the Benedictine monk, Benedictine Abbey of Burana, a monastery in southern Germany. The texts are in Latin and Middle High German, and there are 256 of them. Only a few tonight. They are the work of Goliards. Goliards were footloose monks, priests, and others of the clerical order who had acquired the ability to read and write, which 90% of the population of Europe didn't have in the Middle Ages. And they were disenchanted with the religious life. You might say they were disavowing their vows. The satirical poems and prose were written in the 11th, 12th, and early 13th centuries, and were discovered in 1803 in the monastery of Borin in Bavaria. They contained no music that is decipherable, but they were undoubtedly songs and certainly poems that could be set to music and probably were, but we didn't know exactly how they sounded. This will be the third time the Macomb Symphony has performed this large work, perhaps the grandest choral orchestral work in the repertoire that doesn't have religious implications. In fact, it sort of has anti-religious implications. Our last performance was in 1999, 16 years ago. It seems fitting work to conclude our 40th anniversary year. Karl Orff, a German composer of the 20th century, chose 24 poems out of that huge, huge number to set for modern orchestra, chorus, and soloists in 1936. You should have translations with your programs, but they'll be difficult to read in this light. So take them with you when you leave and pick up your winnings from the auction, and be happy that Karl Orff chose what he did so wisely, because many of them in the original are so suggestive that they would be considered X-rated today. Even as they are, audiences remember, who are under 18 years of age should probably cover their ears. Oh, wait, they're in Latin and Middle High German, it's working. Before we begin, I'd like to thank all of you who came this evening, and especially those who've been with us for a good part of the 40 years that we have been concertizing. Patrons, advertisers, and contributors are all essential to the success of any arts organization, and certainly success to this one. We are both grateful and gratified and encouraged in our music making when you express your appreciation through your efforts on our behalf. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Thank you. mea nota, de corde totaliter, ex mente tota, sum presentialiter, ad sensim remota, vis visam ad taliter, solvitur in
thank you. Thank you. Sitten, miten, miten.